In the second part of the facial analysis, we will go through the analysis of the profile, which is probably the most relevant for the orthodontist, since it's also the part that we can influence most. In order to analyze the profile, we will divide the analysis in upper lip and lower lip. But before getting into these details, we will start with analyzing the position of the lips respect to the face. In order to do this, we can use different lines. Each one with some limitations, however. We can use the elasticity line proposed by Dr. Ricketts. This line runs from the tip of the nose to the soft tissue pogonium. And according to Dr. Ricketts, the upper lip should be 4 mm behind and lower lip 2 mm behind this line. It can be used, of course, but the limitation is that, obviously, it depends on the length of the nose. In case of a very long nose, this line is going to be placed more forward. In case of a retrognathic mandible, this line is going to come more back. So there are parameters that can produce variations. Dr. Jorge Ayala has proposed another line, proposed to use the line running according to the true vertical through the subnasale point with the patient in lateral posture. According to Dr. Jorge Ayala, the upper lip should be about 3 mm in front of this line and the lower lip 1 mm behind or at the level of this line. This line can be useful, but also this one has got a limitation. The subnasale point is very easy to mark and very reproducible in case of a closed nasolabial angle. In case of an open nasolabial angle with a flat upper lip and a nose pointing upwards, it may be very complicated to find the subnasale and can be not very reproducible. We start now to look at the upper lip. An harmonious upper lip is defined as a curve projected forward, like the one depicted in this slide. But what can we do with our orthodontic treatment in order to produce an harmonious upper lip? We have to have a peculiar position of the incisor in respect to the maxilla. This can help us to identify also how we have to position the maxilla related to the face by integrating three different information: the anterior limit of the incision, the position of the incisor respect to the anterior nasal spine, and the torque of the upper incisor. But what are these three parameters? Let's start with the anterior limit of the dentition. The anterior limit of the dentition is the position of the upper incisor in the face on a proper view. In order to identify this, it is needed to take a picture of the patient smiling on lateral view. And by looking at this picture, we can identify if the incisor are harmonious in the face or protrusive or retrusive. Generally speaking, if we trace a line according to the true vertical with the patient in natural posture, and this line we make it run from the soft tissue glabella, we should find the anterior margin of the incisor. So in a patient like the one in this slide, the upper incisor are in an ideal position. Using the same parameter, it's easy to see how in the patient in this slide, the upper incisor are protrusive respect to the face. Or, like in this patient, they are retrusive respect to the face. So this is the first parameter, that is the upper limit, anterior limit of the dentition. The second parameter is the position of the incisor respect to the maxilla. How can we evaluate this? There are two different ways. One way is to use the Dr. Ricketts apogonium line, so a line running from point A to pogonium. According to Dr. Ricketts, the upper incisor should be about 3 or 5 mm in front of this line. The good point with this line is that it is not influenced by variation in the inclination of the occlusal plane. So in case you want to plan, for example, surgery that includes rotation of the occlusal plane, it's a good line to define the position of the incisor respect to the skeletal base. However, we have to think that this is influenced by the temporal mandibular retrusion. So, in case of patient with mandibular retrusion respect to the maxilla, it's not really the ideal line to use. Dr. Mirko Raffaini and Dr. Renato Coccone have proposed another line that is very useful. It's the line that running according to the true vertical from the anterior nasal spine. According to Dr. Coccone and Raffaini, the upper incisor should touch this line. In case the anterior part of the incisor is under the anterior nasal spine, we will have an upper lip that is in equilibrium. The third parameter is, of course, the upper incisor torque, measured in the cephalometric analysis, whatever you decide to use. How to use these parameters? Let's look at this patient. When we look at him, we can see that his upper incisors are normal to procline, so the torque is not very much a big issue. We can see, however, that the position of the incisor is retrusive into the face, but they are the incisor under the anterior nasal spine. We can therefore integrate these three parameters. If we have a retrusive position of the incisor with normal torque and incisor in line with the anterior nasal spine, what does it mean? It means that the wall maxilla is retrusive. It means also that we need to advance the wall maxilla with the upper incisor, and by doing this, we will produce automatically an ideal upper lip with an ideal position of the incisor in the face. This was the analysis of the upper lip. What about the lower lip? The lower lip is defined harmonious if we have an harmonious S shape with a mental labial fold that is defined but not too deep. How can we produce this? In order to produce this, a very good evaluation is given by Dr. Raffaini and Dr. Coccone again. With the lateral cephalometry taking natural posture, if we run a line according to the true vertical from the anterior margin of the lower incisor, we should meet the artis hypogonal, or the artis hypogonal should be a couple of millimeters behind this line. If this is respected, we will have an harmonious lower lip. We have, however, to specify that in the lower lip, the soft tissues, they have a much bigger influence of the upper lip. So we can have patients in which this parameter is not respected and they still have an harmonious lower lip, and on the contrary, patients in which this parameter is respected, but we don't have an harmonious upper lip, a lower lip. So we have to be a bit more case-specific in evaluating the lower lip. The final parameter in looking at the facial aesthetic is looking at the inclination of the occlusal plane. How can we do this? There are two different ways. According to William Arnett, the occlusal plane angle respect to the true vertical through the subnasale is 93 to 97 degrees. This is a possible way to measure it. However, it is required that you have a software, a cephalometric software that can perform a William Arnett analysis. In case this is not true and you don't have it, you can use another way. If you identify the X high point of Ricketts, so you select your Ricketts cephalometric analysis, so you identify the X high point, it is basically the center of the ramus, the prolongation of the occlusal plane should be hitting more or less this point. If the line is above this point, it means that the occlusal plane is too steep, and so you get a posterior rotation of the mandible and or the maxilla. Like in this case, you can see that the prolongation of the occlusal plane is above the xi point, and this corresponds to this image, in which you know that you got a steep occlusal plane. When you know this, you also know that in a patient like this, the ideal treatment will be actually a rotation, an anterior rotation of the occlusal plane, which was done with surgery in order to produce an enhancement of the